takes us into the City of Valdosta cases, first of which is VA-2023-09.
Good morning.
So thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a tabled item from a month ago. You may recall from back to the May 22nd meeting. It is a plan development request by Machouse Investments for property located. This is for parcels 2.2 acres, but located on the west side of North Oak Street between West Cranford Avenue and West Alden Avenue. The zoning map on the screen in your packet shows the split zoning characteristic of R6 and DR-10, about 50-50 in terms of the lot area. You may recall the zoning case from last fall that implemented this rezoning. As we talked about during the rezoning case, the applicant was going to put together a residential plan development proposal, and that is the purpose of the public hearings now. Character areas established residential, as you see on the map on the screen, which is most of the North Oak Street corridor. Aerial imagery, you can see the land use pattern around the subject property. The property itself is mostly wooded, old growth forest, two existing houses that face West Alden. The rest of the property is mostly vacant, at least under the tree canopy. You see the apartment complexes to the north of West Cranford, that is the Timbers Apartments, developed in the past 15 years. A lot of homes elsewhere nearby. As noted in your packet, this property is within the local historic district of Valdosta. Two existing houses are also contributing to resources of the Berkeley North National Register District, which comes down Alden Avenue. Survey of your property shows the actual location of the zoning line, the footprints of the two existing houses. Some photographs, subject property. This is a house on the corner, what we call the Gulliver House. Next door is the McDonald House. Existing residences that have been sitting empty for many years. Obvious need of some renovation and some TLC. Other pictures of the subject property include this view looking southward along Oak Street. Fairly new city sidewalk is placed on the east side of the right of way. As you see, it's sort of a cleared, mowed area underneath the trees. This is a view looking into the interior. You get a little sense of some of the trees that exist on the property. On the back side of one of the existing houses for a little extra TLC, I think, is going to be needed. And then some other pictures that I took of the interior to show the trees, but also some mature camellia bushes that are on the site. As we talked about in the work session, this property 67 years ago was a commercial nursery before the time that Valdosta had zoning. And some remnants of that use were there in terms of some of the vegetation, I think some building foundations and some other things over there. Close-up view of the camellias, they just like the houses, also need some TLC. And then some of the tree canopy above, mostly pine trees, but there's some other species as well. In your packet, I haven't gotten to it yet, but in there is a tree survey that was prepared by the applicant to show locations of the trees. And then there's an index chart to go with it that shows that. A footnote to that is that it's something that's over and above the development requirements for a subdivision and single-family zoning. But it's something that I had requested of the applicant back in the beginning of our discussions because I knew there would be some questions. Having some information at your fingertips to help you make a better informed decision. Adjacent properties, this is the Timbers to the north of West Cranford Avenue. Buildings there are two-story with built townhouse style. Some are traditional apartments. As you can see, they're fairly close to Cranford Avenue in terms of the setback. This is the view looking eastward down Cranford. You see the apartments on the left. The subject property is there on the immediate right. Further down Cranford, as you get closer to Patterson Street, the land use pattern changes from residential to that of professional offices. The view looking southward down Oak Street, with the sidewalk, the subject property is on the immediate left. And then you get to the intersection of Alden and Oak. This is looking to the southwest, the single family residence on the opposite corner of the subject property. Then some of the houses along West Alden, where he went eastward back toward Patterson. There's a couple of houses here. This is the house on the north side of Alden that's immediately next to the subject property. In your pack, of course, is the fee survey, a cautionary note, I'm going to talk about it in the work session. It is based on the old layout pattern, which showed 11 blocks, Alden is now proposing 10 blocks, and reduced one of those. And also, Alden has shifted the internal road a few feet, and also widened its pathway. It is the same basic layout, but I didn't want the layout of the lots and road on this map to be a point of confusion. The main purpose of this was to show the trees in its survey, which was actually done several months ago. The central layout is edited, is also in the packet, that shows the proposed configuration now, which is 10 lots, is to be all single-family homes. Like we talked about at the work session, under DR-10 and R6 zoning, duplex residential is a use by right. There have been lot area and lot width requirements for that. Conventionally, the property has enough lot area and lot frontage to do up to 8 duplex lots at 16 dwelling units. The main gist of the applicant's proposal is to set that aside and instead do 10 single family homes instead of the duplexes. The difference is that in his layout, it would require a private road on the interior to provide a little bit of extra access and frontage to interior lots arranged in sort of a village pattern. We'll get into more details in a moment. The conceptual layout is as you see on the screen and in your packet. Some of the boundary lines are highlighted in red. You see proposed building setback lines. This is to be a private road, 40 feet wide, shared parking on the north end of that in the middle with a shared mailbox cluster. The areas highlighted in green is where there's possibly to be shared driveways to these individual lots. As we talked about in the work session, it has the 3 houses facing Alden, 2 of them existing, 1 is proposed. But the other group of lots, the other 7, on what is now vacant portions of the property, would all be facing the interior. It would be a 7-foot, or perhaps 7 to 8 foot tall garden wall around the perimeter, decorative, consists of wood and brick. Those would become the backyards of these houses. So they would face inward to this internal street system. A couple of them along West Cranford might have some rear access gates to garages there. So it's sort of a creative pattern than what we normally see conventionally. New house elevations, this is on the easternmost house along Alden. Fairly large home, almost 3,200 square feet. 2-story in the back, 2 garages, historically compatible. This has already been reviewed by the Historic Preservation Commission on May 1st. They have already granted approval to the construction of this new house on that eastern lot facing Alden. They have also granted approval for the proposed renovation of the McDonald House, which is the middle house on Alden. They have also granted conceptual approval to this layout, with the caveat that any and all new construction of houses on these individual lots, including the final renovation on the corner lot, which is lot number 10 of the Gulliver House, that they will review those case by case individually when it comes time for construction. So each of the houses in here will be held to the design guidelines of the local historic district. Another view in your packet, this is the 3D view of that large house that's being proposed. Some other graphics in your packet, showing a little bit of color and 3-dimensional. This is from above Alden Avenue looking northward up the interior drive. Again, this is before the change in the layout. Remember when we tabled this, at that point we were looking at 11 lots. There was a concern that perhaps it was getting a little crowded in the north end. These graphics predate the change. But again, it shows the general layout of rooftops and where some future houses might be. The opposite view, this is from above Cranford Avenue looking south. This is a little better view of the proposed wall and fence combination and how the shared driveway gates onto Cranford might look as it relates to garages and the rear side of these houses. Otherwise, there's more information in your packet, including a petition from the local neighborhood. I think some of the neighbors are here to address that. Before we go any further, and I end up forgetting, on the petition, the neighbors requested that I read into the record the preamble of the petition itself. So if you'll bear with me, Mr. Chairman. This is, we, the undersigned homeowners residing in and adjacent to the Berkeley North Historic District, ask that the following concerns and requests of ours be carefully considered and be read into the record at each public meeting in consideration of the proposed Machouse plan development bounded by North Oak Street, West Alden Avenue, and West Cranford Avenue. This property has for many decades been a rare example of an urban green space surrounded by a historic neighborhood, and it has many tall canopy trees that are important to the character of our neighborhood. We ask that sensitivity be shown toward the goal of preserving as many of these specimen canopy trees as possible during both planning and construction. Exact placement and alignment of buildings, driveways, etc., should be decided after the location of specimen canopy trees are precisely determined, so that whatever adjustments might be made in footprints will be made in preservation of important trees. We believe this will constitute added value to many prospective homeowners and future neighbors, just as many of us bought our homes in part because they were in a wooded neighborhood. We also urge the owner and developer to meet with us to discuss this issue more specifically. So as we talk about the work session, trees are becoming a point of concern for the neighbors, hence the tree survey. In reviewing this, staff is recommending approval after finding it consists with a comprehensive plan, the plan development review criteria, which those answers are in the packet. We're recommending approval subject to 9 conditions. The number of 9 is not unusual for plan developments, although these are a little bit lengthy. We went over them a little bit in the work session. If you'd like, I could go through them in detail for this public hearing. Normally, I would do so for the benefit of the public. And I also know the public has requested and received copies of this packet, so they have these in front. The only thing I would want to highlight to you is right before the meeting at your station, I placed a revised text to condition number 3, which adds a little bit in the yellow highlighted portion there at the bottom. That has to do with the public versus private easements shown on the master plan. One other note that applicant brought to my attention right before the meeting, in addition number 8, it makes a reference to drainage / utilities infrastructure being maintained as private utilities infrastructure is remaining public. So the note is simply strike that word utilities from the third line there, number 8. We can go through these in detail if you would like. Otherwise, I can entertain questions about them. The applicant is here. They can give you more details about the nature and the details of the houses they're proposing, the covenants, homeowner association, and so forth, timeline. But other than that, we'd like to try and answer any questions you might have for them.
Thank you, Matt.
Commissioners, any questions? Or?
I got one thing if you don't mind.
No, not at all.
Matt, just curious, I know the revised 11 and 10 we got today, it talks about maybe 2 houses may have rear entry garages off of West Cranford. I'm just curious, is that a problem with all 4 of them having rear entry? I'm just for a cost effective reason. I'm just curious.
There's a difference between how they're describing it in the letter of intent for saying 2. Staff's recommendation is for a maximum of 2. Whether they be single serve driveways or shared driveways. This schematic that's on your screen shows 2 shared driveways that services 4 houses. Staff's opinion, and this is also an engineering concern, is we do not want a plethora of driveways on West Cranford and consolidating them 2 homes into 1 gated drive. We think it's more attractive and better for the streetscape. So staff worded that condition on purpose to say no more than 2 driveways, whether they be shared or not. Applicant could do 1, could do none, or do all 2, or any combination of shared or single. So it precludes them from having 3 or 4 driveways, but only 2 possibilities there.
And without me really home to these conditions, is there a condition about that 1 lot that cannot open on the Oak Street?
Correct. If you look at this is the middle lot on the Oak Street frontage. It's actually lot number two, I think, or number of the system. We were trying to avoid extra driveways on the Oak Street if it's not necessary. The plan is for lot number two to have its primary access to the common area. The houses are only facing it anyway. Lot number two is not quite as big as some of the others.
That's my question. Could he choose to face it out if he wanted to have more visibility from Oak Street? More historical elevations?
It would, except the proposal in the plan development is a 7 to 8 foot wall around the perimeter. So the wall says you're not going to be able to see the front of the house really.
Is that 7 foot wall perimeter on Cranford also?
Correct. It would be around the group of seven new lots. So if the three that are facing Alden are not enclosed by the decorative wall, the other seven behind them are included. And you can see that a little bit better in this picture. This is the view looking northward from Alden. You see the two houses facing Alden. You can use some imagination. The Gulliver house is in the lower left corner of this picture. The other seven are behind. They form a little encapsulated village enclosed by the wall. The plan is to face them inward so they become more of their own residential village.
Okay. And one final thing. Do I read condition number seven that says the signage for this development is going to be 150 feet off the road?
The signage, correct. The idea is for the shared access drive to be a shared residential drive or so, not a full street. There's not many houses with a narrow pathway. There's not really enough room there to add signage and landscaping with all the pavement that needs to be there as well. Typically with larger subdivisions, we see the requirement. Actually, the requirement for landscaping doesn't kick in until you get 50 lots. We're a long ways from that.
I think my question is this, and of course I'm not doing any of it. I'm just curious, you wouldn't grant the applicant some signage on this beautiful brick wall that fronts Oak Street?
I would not. It would be decorative. There's no access to the development from Oak Street.
There's not going to be no access to 150 foot back in a common area.
No.
Well, we didn't see the sign. It's great.
And that was a discussion I had with the applicant, and that is actually part of the applicant's proposal. The way he can address this better than I. As you enter this shared drive, you pass the pillars into the back part of it, you would like to put some plaques there.
Say that again now.
As you drive northward up the shared drive between these two houses, and you come to the brick wall, there's pillars at the corner.
Yes.
And that's where he's wanting to put the signage. In other words, a small private residential.
So the signage would actually appear between lots 1 and 7, not 6 and 7, as per conditions.
Between lots 1 and 7 on the filters, behind 8 and 9.
Right. I'm just curious. It says in conditions it's going to be for the lots 6 and 7. I'm just curious.
Yeah,
and that's on that wall 150 feet back.
And that may be my error in the old numbering system.
No problem, sir.
Matt, I see on fire it says no comment at this time, and I'm looking at the back of that there. They didn't respond as to whether that's enough room for a fire truck.
They absolutely did. I had to make sure of that.
Okay.
And even got a copy of the page of the International Fire Code to go with it.
Okay.
That is actually a hammerhead turnaround in lieu of a cul-de-sac. Is allowed by right in the city's development code as long as it meets fire code standards. And that hammerhead meets fire code standards.
Okay.
Ratified by the fire office.
Okay.
That was comment. Very specific.
Yeah, okay.
I understand.
That's it. It just looked like it was going to be trouble turning down there now.
It's 120 feet across, which is the minimum. Proposed design, that's 120 feet of hard pavement. The driveways will extend just a little bit further into the footsteps.
Okay.
And I just have one question, it's purely technical, it's related to condition six. Is everything spelled out in condition six, not what the city arborist does anyway on a project like this?
Correct. Property zone, single family and duplex residential under the city's development code, that zoning district or even single family uses elsewhere are exempt from the city street landscape ordinance, and includes tree permitting, tree removals, supplemental plantings and all of that. However, the city does distinguish canopy trees and specimen trees, which, to put it in layman's terms, streets that are on public property, in other words, a public right-of-way, or under the jurisdiction of the city arborist. Trees that are in proximity to the right-of-way line and overhang a public right-of-way is under the jurisdiction of the city arborist. So that's what condition six is talking about. The city arborist has made several visits to the site. The latest was late last week. And from my hearing his conversation, he identified 26 trees on this property or in the adjacent right-of-way that are under his jurisdiction. He has made note of those. They're, I guess, for lack of a better term, on his radar screen. And so when it comes time for subdivision and development of these properties, those will be addressed individually then. But those are the trees that fall under his jurisdiction.
26 of the 93 trees he has jurisdiction over.
Something like that. I didn't count up how many there were total, but it sounds about right. If this next chart says 93, then that's what's on here. So the rest of it on private property. And just to put it in perspective, all trees on private property not under his jurisdiction are subject to removal. At the owner's discretion or the developer's discretion.
Can be removed.
Can be.
Gotcha.
This applicant will address that in greater detail, but as I relay to you at the work session, this applicant is proposing not to necessarily clear cut the property, but selectively determine which needs to be preserved. And that might include some relocation of some of the bushes which are not in the fully trees.
Thank you. Good explanation. Appreciate
it, sir.
Any other questions for Mr. Martin at this point? Then we will open the public hearing portion of this application. Is there anyone here this evening that would like to speak in favor of this application? If so, please come forward, state your name and address for the record.
Good evening, Commissioners. Can y'all hear us?
I can. I don't know about the people behind you.
Bill Nigel, 1007 North Patterson Street. We have the applicant, Machouse Investments. Mr. Walden and I, he's the principal of Machouse Investments. We're going to try and tag team this and get both of us up here to answer questions as they arise. Thank you, Mr. Martin, for the summary. That was a good job and did a lot of my job, I feel like. But this is, you know, I just personally want to say, lived in the historic district for over a decade. Just sold our house there about a year and a half ago. I've been working with Mr. Walden on this project probably about a year, 9 months now. And it's one that I've always been excited about. You know, usually in these areas in the city, you know, we're coming in, we're asking you for a rezoning. Let's put some multifamily in. Let's do something like that. I mean, these are going to be single-family residences, and they're going to be upscale single-family residences. You know, 2,000 square foot, 3,500 square foot, over $500,000 houses. So this is something that's going to be great for this area. It's going to be great for this city, and I really think this project has a ton of potential. I hope y'all see it in the second half. So just to back up, there will be three houses along Alden. It'll face out to Alden. The rest of the houses will face the interior road that will be put in. The architecture will keep with the local historic district and those architectural parameters. Obviously, we've got to do that. Anything that's going to be built is going to get through the HPC for them to approve as well. and we're perfectly fine with that. Mr. Walton, this is not going to be the type of residential subdivision. It's only 10 lots, and he's not planning on selling any of these lots off to other builders. I mean, he's the developer, he's the builder. You know, this is his baby, this is his project from start to finish. And I think that's important because everything's going to be uniform, hopefully. You know, everything's going to coexist. And I think that starts with renovating the two houses on Alden. You've seen the pictures of those houses. I mean, it's going to take a lot of work, but there's a lot of potential there, and I think all of us see that. So you're looking at somebody here who's not afraid to buy it off. You're looking at somebody here who has just won a City of Mount Austin Historic Preservation Award for other renovations he's done in the area. So this is the right person to do this project. I realize that any project like this, there's going to be a change. These houses, this has been a greenscape in the city for some time. With changes come concerns. I mean, people are used to driving by these lots, and even though they're looking at some houses that have seen better days, there's a lot of greenery and trees back there. And it's, I don't speak for you. I don't think it's Mr. Walden's intent to go in and clear these trees out. I mean, he's going to try and keep what he can. Of course, we've got to put a road in, we've got houses in, but especially the camellia bushes. I mean, some of the shrubs and trees that have been there, and we can relocate and put along the exterior or put in some of these yards. I mean, the intent is to keep those. I realize there's some existing tree canopy with pine trees. We'll do what we can to keep them. We'll try and work around it, but. Some of those may have to go. We're completely agreeable and working with the arborist and have been working with the arborist to see that this project takes into account those sensitivities. So, there will be covenants. There will be common areas. And, I mean, we need common areas because it's going to be a private road. It's not going to be city maintained. Okay? We're going to have private detention facilities. So we've got to have Homeowners Association to maintain, that road and those stormwater detention facilities, to maintain the mail kiosk, and we're going to have some vegetation that's going to have to be maintained that's in the city right-of-way as well. So that will all be addressed in the covenants. HOA will be formed to take care of those common areas. There will be architectural covenants on top of us having to go back through the HPC, these architectural renderings. There will be guidelines and requirements as to what these houses, minimum square footage, the materials that are used, foundations. I always hate this. Break the foundations, if there's foundations, crawl space, things like that to make sure that these houses are going to look good. I will tell you also the conditions were comfortable. The applicant's been working for 9 months now with the city on this project and has worked hand in hand with Mr. Martin in putting these conditions together to where we're comfortable with them, and I think the city's comfortable with them as well. I want to close by saying, and I know there's some other people here to speak, and I know y'all may have questions for us, but this is a piece of property that's been in the McDonald family for generations. And I think it's a testament to this project and to this builder and this developer that Ms. Susan Borden, is interested in under a letter of intent to buy one of these houses. I mean, she's the daughter of Mr. and Mrs. McDonald, and wants to come back here and live on this property and buy one of these houses that Mr. Walton's going to renovate. So, there's a lot of trust there with the family. With Mr. Walden as being a good steward for this property, this family property. And, it's just great that one of their children are coming back to live in one of these homes and live on this property. So we're here to answer any questions you have for us.
Thank you, Mr. Nodge. Commissioners, any questions for Mr. Nodge or Mr. Walton?
I have a question. As it's developed, the owner, did you, at any time, did you meet with the residents that reside, the homeowners reside in that particular area?
I did not.
Now, I think I will jump in and say some of this stuff came up, well, I don't know when a letter was submitted, 2 weeks ago. You were out of town. I got pulled in a little late. We can certainly talk to those neighbors. I know that projects along this corridor there, Alden and Oak Street, trees have always been a sensitive topic. I know this came up with timbers, some of the properties before. All I can say is that I can emphasize that we are sensitive to those concerns. I think one of the great things about this neighborhood and this area of Alasta is the trees, mature trees and plants. And we want to try and preserve that to the extent we do.
Any other questions for the gentleman? Thank you very much. Is there anyone else here this evening that would like to speak in favor of this application? So please come forward. State your name and address for the record.
Hi, my name is Susan McDonald Morgan. I'm going to talk a little loud so my father can hear me. We actually reside at 96203 Montego Bay, Fernandina Beach, Florida, right now. My background, I'm going to give you a little bit about my resume, I suppose. One of the jobs that I cherished was working for a company called Landscape Ornamentals in Albany, Georgia, where my business friend and boss, she and I sold trees throughout the southeastern United States. And our family, for over four generations, has had McDonald Nurseries and Landscaping. And I made lots of notes here for you tonight, but I'm going to spare you all of that. I do want to hit on a couple of highlights. And one is that that between the last four generations, the McDonald's have planted, shared, sold, grafted, transplanted flowers, shrubs, and ornamentals and trees in Lowndes County for the purpose of beautifying the streetscapes, homes, businesses throughout the county. In fact, the only family who's planted more trees in Lowndes County than the McDonald's are the Langdales. But the McDonald Nursery is who the Langdales called when they wanted to beautify their very own homes and offices. So I'm here to let the neighbors know that this property is very dear to us, even though it has been sold. And selling the property was a major event in our family's life. And there were many investors who had shown interest in this property. And as Mr. Martin mentioned, up to 16 units could have been put on this property. Now, what he didn't mention were how many bedrooms could be in each of those units. 3 to 4. In each of those units. You're talking parking for, 50 to 74 cars. It would be a lot more than what you're looking at with this project right here that Avery has done. Avery Walden approached us in the fall of 21, and the more we got to know him, the more we appreciated not only his quality of work on the many projects he had in this very neighborhood, but also his genuine concern for the impact of his work. I made reference to him and I said, Avery, you're kind of like an artist because he really takes pride in what he's doing. David and I, my husband, for the last decades, I'll have to say now, we have never lived in anything but an old home. In fact, I've remodeled three old homes in downtown Apalachicola. We have just finished a renovation on about 2 to 3 years ago in Fernandina Beach on an 1850s home in downtown. We've worked with historic districts and adhere to landscaping and fencing and all of that in all of our projects. We've recently sold our home in Fernandina Beach, and as it was mentioned, David and I are moving back to Valdosta, and we are going to be the first purchase that Mr. Walden is going to have in this project. We're buying the McDonald House, and this will make, with our grandchildren and my great nieces and nephews in the McDonald family, six generations that will get to play, pray, and enjoy this house that has truly been blessed by God in our family. And I would like to address the petition, because I think it was very interesting.
Ms. Morgan, I'm sorry to interrupt you. You're doing a fantastic job.
Okay.
You exceeded the time a lot, but I'll allow you a little more time. Just please try to wrap it up.
I will. Thank you very much. I'm going to have a little bit of
I'm enjoying
it. With the petition, I did notice that they put on there that this beautiful green urban greenscape surrounded by historic homes. I'd like to correct that for the record to say that this was a family farm complete with cow, chicken, and a family that farmed there. And actually, the homes were built up around the farm. So we are familiar with progress, and we are familiar with how to adapt and how to preserve our surroundings. I can guarantee the neighbors that we will be planting, transplanting, and improving this property by moving trees and adding new ones. And we will take pride in this, because this is the legacy for our family, and also, I believe, for Valdosta and Lowndes County.
Thank you very much. That was very, very good. If there's anyone else who would like to speak in favor of this, I'll allow 1 minute, since so many people have come. Anyone else who would like to speak in favor of this application? Is there anyone here this evening who would like to speak against this application? If so, please come forward and state your name and address for the record.
I'm Nancy Hobby, 707 Smithfire Drive. I'm really not against this project. I'm very much for it. We own the house directly across the street from the McDonald House, and my family and the McDonald family have been friends for years, and they were wonderful neighbors. My sister and I still own that house. We've owned it since the 50s when my dad built it. No, it's the next one.
Yeah.
That one right there. It is currently a rental house, even though people ask me all the time who I've sold it to, because it is probably the most pristine rental house in town, and I make sure it stays that way. I'm familiar with Mr. Walden. I've seen his work. He does outstanding work. I told him last year at this meeting that I supported him 100%. My problem has been, within the last 2 weeks, this private road that he is going to put in. From what Mr. Martin has shown me, it will come out, the cars will come out, and they will shine their lights directly onto our house. We have a living room on the front. We have a master bedroom on the front. And even though I rent this house, I rent it to families. I do not rent it to college students. So it has been, I try to keep in mind the neighborhood, the neighbors. I want to be a good neighbor. And I've lost money by not renting it to college students. My concern is the traffic. Mr. Martin and I talked about this. I said, even today, there are days that I cannot back out of my driveway because traffic has backed up at Oak and Alden to my driveway. This will be another thing you'll have to watch. You back out, you've got to watch from two directions. Now I'm going to have to watch behind me. It seems like the cars coming from the west going toward Patterson, are going much faster. There's a curve on the other side of Oak Street on Alden. And they fly. This is a racetrack. The first week of June, on a Tuesday, this past June, on a Tuesday, there was a wreck at the intersection. I've been doing some work on my house because I'm in between tenants. And the painter said there was another wreck that same week. This has been going on for 40 years. I haven't lived there in 40 years, but I've been going on a regular basis in 40 years. I talked to Mr. Martin. He said when he was putting out signs, he was not aware of it. But at 5 o'clock, he's on his way home. This is when the traffic, it's a feeder road. I think it's, is it a collector?
It's a collector.
And they just zoom. So I'm very concerned about this traffic. And I know that he said that code says that you've got to have a road so many feet from the intersection. And this is code. But I've also seen examples, and we probably all have, where they met code and they underestimated traffic, and then you have a problem. And it's too late after you've let everything go. So I'm very concerned about the location of this driveway. And on a personal note, maybe it won't affect my rentals. I might be living over there one day. I might decide to scale back down and go back over there. But I just feel like when you've put into a neighborhood, you've been responsible, and I want this project to go forward. I think it will improve the value of everybody's house in the neighborhood. And it's certainly going to be nice to look at from our side of the street. But I'm just very concerned about this road and the location of it. He didn't tell me this last year at this time, and I don't know. I know that they've tried to squeeze in this 3,000 square foot house, and you know they're moving things around. But I'm against this road being in the location unless he can show me that it's not going to be shining right into. And I think it needs moving down because of traffic. And also, the college is out of session right now, and some of the schools, so that has drastically reduced traffic that goes through there. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Is there anyone else here this evening that would like to speak against this application? Sir, please state your name and address for the record.
Dr. Brad Bergstrom, 2101 Terrace. I live on Short Life on this site. As one of the signatories of the petition, first of all, I'd like to thank Matt for his introduction to that. I've also talked to pretty much everybody else who signed the petition. And one of the main points was that obviously the tree canopy is an important aspect of the character of our neighborhood. But another part that was in the petition, but many of the signers who many of whom are decades-long residents, including myself, mentioned was the density of this development not matching. Let's just take Alden Street between Patterson and Oak. I got on Valor, and I looked at every single family property along that stretch of Alden Street, and then I came up Oak Street across Oak Street from this development. 21 lots, averaging 0.36 acres, which is 15,700 square feet. Now this development takes 2.2 acres, divides it into 10 lots and a road. And that gives you an average lot size of 0.17 acres or 7,600 square feet. That's less than half the average lot size. And yet, it's been touted how upscale and big these houses are. If I could afford a $500,000 house, I wouldn't want a 6,000 square foot lot. And it's in the file here on page 4. I don't think it's been mentioned tonight, but page 4 under proposed deviation for minimum lot area, it indicates that 40% of these lots are going to be below code in size. In other words, 4 of the 10 lots are below the minimum for the DR-10 portion of 10,000 square feet. So if you're trying to put an awful lot of construction, hardscape footprint into a small area, that in and of itself is going to be damaging to the character of the neighborhood, and it's also going to impinge on the other stated sentiment, at least, of saving as much of the tree canopy as possible. You just, it's a zero-sum game. So I'm just wondering why you all are going to be presumably voting on variance to the ordinance by approving these 4 out of 10 lots that being below the minimum required size. Why not just scale it back by however many lots, 1 or 2, so that they all come out to code, so that none of them is below the minimum required. I think that way you'd, the neighbors I talked to would a whole lot rather see that lesser density in and of itself, and to the extent that that would also affect and facilitate perhaps the preservation of more of the tree canopy.
We still have some time. Is there anyone else here this evening that would like to speak against this application? Ma'am, please state your name and address for the record, please.
First, let me apologize for the get up, but I have conjunctivitis and I didn't want to spread it. So
I'll do it.
My name is Lorraine Sherrickson. I live at 2006 North Oak Street.
Did you spell your name?
Yeah. SCHMERTZING. You were out of those little pieces of paper right there.
Did you get the address, Mom?
No,
sorry. Your address, please.
2006 North Oak Street.
Thank you.
And I'd like to first let you know how thankful I am to Matt for all his help, and you guys should really appreciate him because he was wonderful in helping me understand the documents and everything before we came. But these documents are related to what I consider currently nicely wooded lot that I happen to see out my bedroom window because I'm directly across the street. So if all goes well for the folks on the other side of the aisle, in a few short years I realize I'll be seeing a fence and rooftops as opposed to the view that I've had for the last 20 years. As you might imagine, if it were you, you wouldn't exactly welcome that change either. And although I don't particularly want the change, I do realize how much worse it could be, and the good reputation the developer has for architectural taste and the McDonald's have for landscaping. I'm very grateful for that, and I truly appreciate both of them and their efforts. I also realize the arborist isn't through with this yet, and so there will be more conversations to be had. But because the tree survey was brought up previously, I feel the need to mention that we did walk the lot and measure and try to locate those trees, and that tree map was not accurate. And so in light of the inaccuracies or the exact footprint of the present trees in relation to the city map, to the site map, I'm not sure why we can't have one of these that has the trees that the arborist already identified on it, overlaid on where the buildings are going to go so that we can really see which trees are going to be in question. But anyway, so since we can't see the exact footprint of the present trees, we can't really determine the degree of devastation to the existing tree canopy, which is obviously typical for that neighborhood, as you can see from all the photos. And we don't know, but somebody apparently knows which trees and camellias will actually be saved and relocated. I'm unclear why these points of confusion couldn't be resolved by simply tagging trees that stay and marking the plants that might be moved, so that we could better understand what was going to be happening across the street. Not that it would change anything, but at least we would be clearer, since it seems possible. I'm also unclear why this shouldn't be done before approval is granted for the development, or why the developer hasn't chosen to do it yet, knowing this has been a big point of concern within the immediate community. And it may not matter that I'm unclear, but I would hope that it would matter to you whether you're clear or unclear before you make any kind of recommendations on what to do next. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gretchen. Technically speaking, we've run out of time. If there is anyone else here that would like to speak against this, I will allow 1 minute for a citizen who did take the time to come to the meeting. Since there are none, that will close the public hearing portion on this application. Commissioners, yeah, Commissioner, any other comments?
Yes. Can I ask Matt a question?
Of course.
Matt, what's your response to the code? It's not a solid code. The one you brought up about less than 10,000.
Full lottery question.
Yeah. Depends on your perspective and how you look at the maps.
Matt, tell me, is your question about Mr. Burton's comments about lot size?
Yes.
Okay, that's all right. I want to be sure what we're talking about.
If you look at the zoning map on the screen, which is also in your packet, DR-10 zoning is the zoning pattern along West Alden Avenue. Keep in mind this property split zone DR-10-06. The layout of the 10 lots shows some different sizes. The largest lot is over 11,000 square feet. The others are 6,000 on up. The average is around 7,600 square feet. That was one of the things I had looked at in terms of development pattern. DR-10 and R-6 each allow a house or a duplex. The only requirement is if you build a duplex on those lots, the lot has to be a little bit larger. So DR-10, for example, is a minimum of 10,000 square feet for a house, 13,000 for a duplex. One of the things that enters the picture is if you were to take the 13,000 square foot lot for a duplex, that's an average of 6,500. Per dwelling unit. In R6, the lot sizes are a little bit smaller. It's 6,000 for a house, 9,000 for a duplex. If you look at the duplex lot, that averages 4,500 square feet per dwelling unit. So part of this proposal is to set aside the duplex dwelling unit density that's allowed there without going through a public hearing and swap that in for restriction that it be single family homes only. Along the Alden Street frontage, yes, density is important. DR-10 pattern is important. They're proposing three lots along there. Two of them are more than the 80-foot minimum width. One is almost 80 feet at 68. That's the new lot to the east of the road. If it weren't for the road, you could get three lots in there easily, although that lot has frontage on the private road that's over 100 feet. Generally speaking, you've got the rhythm of a DR-10 lot along Alden. You just don't have, in terms of width, you just don't have the depth. A big thing to consider on the north side of the property, we have R6 and DR-10. Across the street to the north, that is owned RP, developed multifamily at 18 units per acre. That's a lot more dense than an R10 subdivision, which is 4 units per acre. So that enters the picture as well. The pattern around that is mostly single family, but not exclusively single family. Hence the greater density of the proposal as you see it is on West Cranford, as it should be, and isolated for houses instead of duplexes. Total of 10 dwelling units instead of a maximum of 16.
Okay, I guess.
So yes, that was part of status call process.
Yeah.
That was the main question is if this was approved and it gets to that point, is this going to pose a problem and have to be revisited or whatever? But the way you see it, it's not going to pose a problem.
No, with the plan development, one of the provisions in the code is flexibility of development standards. By code, we itemize all the deviations from the standard development code. Allows an applicant to propose the deviations. It's not automatic. The language in the code is guideline when we review it is that you might not comply with the letter of the code.
it certainly should comply with the intent of the code, particularly when it comes to public safety. Hence the fire department turnaround, that was a non-negotiable. That had to be complied with. Standard engineering design for safe roads and so on, that's also a non-negotiable. All of those are complied with. In the realm of all the plan developments we've reviewed over the past several years, this one has relatively minor deviations compared to some. You might recall we've had others, particularly the non-residential variety, where there's a much longer list. So this one, most of it has to do with a few differences in lot sizes. Part of that stems from the difference in zoning, which just really adds confusion to the picture. In my view, the greatest of the deviation are reduced setbacks. The first of that is on internal lot lines, like we often see in plan developments. That's really most of the change. What the applicant did do to meet the intent, and it's in the proposed plan, and I'll finish with this comment. If you look at that development layout, you can't see it on here unless you read the fine print. Notice the red dashed lines. Those are the minimum building setbacks. You notice I put in the conditions that the developer complies with these setbacks without variance. So in other words, no less than what's here. Oak Street is R15 on the west side, higher density on the east. I requested a little higher setback along Oak to match the development pattern. You notice there they're proposing 15 feet. There are some existing homes on Oak, because I did look at them, that are less than 15 feet from the right-of-way. One is maybe 8 feet at most. Those are houses that predate the adoption of zoning. So that's how they got there. But Oak Street, there's a very big difference between one side of the road and the other. I wanted this proposal on the east side to match the setback pattern on the east side. 15 feet seems to do that. So there you have greater setbacks. On Cranford, it's reduced. But remember, the apartments on Cranford are pretty close to the road with two-story buildings and nothing to separate, multifamily. So they are a tighter setback is in order. Internal lot lines within the village, you can't see it unless you're in the middle of the development. There, it was okay. On Alden, you've got two existing houses that are going to be where they are. So that's going to be okay as well.
Staff, any other questions for Ms. Martin? Then I will entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Commissioner Wilson.
To me, it sounds like a great development. I know there's issues with the problem with the entrance and exit, but it's got to be somewhere, unfortunately, if you don't get developed. The fact that they have worked with the Historical Society, and the Historical Society has gone along with their part of development with our history with the Historical Society, obviously doing something right. So I make a motion we recommend approval on VA-2023-09 with the
Nine conditions. As amended.
As amended, yes.
I'll second.
You got a second, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to go in for a record and say that on my time sitting on the Planning Commission here, we've had multiplicity of islands that have been brought to us by different developers with, you know, different plans throughout the year, and unfortunately none of them has made it all the way through, but they have not made it through the process. And I would say, I would echo Mr. Willis's comments that the project looks absolutely amazing.